morning.
Good morning.
Thanks for coming. It's so much fun to see all of you here. Hopefully, I won't get nervous and all the words will come out right. Today, the topic is going to be health and conscientiousness, and it's based on the book by Givaldo Franco with almost the same name, Times of Health and Conscientiousness. I concentrated on the second part of the book because there's a lot of information. So I thought it was a good place to start is, what is conscientiousness? And I looked it up in the dictionary, and it's the act of being conscious. So that didn't help me very much. But it's the act of being mindful, the act of being aware. In fact, most conscientious people are actually responsible, reliable, disciplined, kind of like us. We're here instead of at the beach. And also, conscientiousness is that moment that we feel so much inner balance and so much harmony that we can actually discern what's right from wrong. It's not an intellectual process. We don't think about this. It's actually an evolutionary process that helps us to evaluate critical factors like what's right from wrong, what's honor versus dishonor, responsibility versus irresponsibility, and so forth. So in the spirits book, Kardec asks the spirits, so how do we distinguish good from bad? And the spirits tell us that everything that's good is in harmony with God's laws, and God's laws are in our conscience. Everything that deviates from that is evil. So if God's laws are in our conscience, and conscientiousness is the act of being conscious, I thought that we should talk a little bit about God's laws. What are they? Well, they're the unchanging and eternal laws that govern our universe. They include both the physical laws, our physical realm, the laws of nature, and the laws, the moral laws and ethical laws. So I just thought I would talk about a couple of those laws. And since it's 4th of July, I felt that the law of equality was important to mention. Because the spirits tell us that all spirits are created equal. And I think a lot of you have remembered that in our Declaration of Independence, Thomas Jefferson said, all men are created equal. So all spirits, all men are spirits, right? So it's basically, he said exactly the same thing. So another law, we're all different, right? We're not equal. I hear a lot of people saying, well, you know, we're not equal, we can't have equal laws, we can't treat people equally because we're not equal. Well, if you look around this room, we're not equal. We have a dentist, a jeweler, a teacher. We have all sorts of different people here. Some people with musical talent, some people are artistic. So, but our intellect and our character really is determined by our spiritual development, not by our creation. We all come equally from the same source. We all come from love, which is another one of the law of love, compassion, and justice. We have the law of reproduction, preservation, and destruction. And this one here I brought up on purpose because we have a little private joke in our study group, is that we always say on Wednesday, man, the lecture on Sunday was so great. What was it about? And we know it was great. We just can't remember. So I actually did something that, if you don't remember anything else, this little song is going to drive you crazy, because the law of reproduction, preservation, and destruction reminds me of the circle of life in Lion King. How do I do this? Help.
Just press the button on to the right.
We do?
Press the right button.
Drives you crazy all day long. You're going to have that song on your mind, and you will remember me. Anyway, if you're interested in the other laws, that wasn't really what the lecture is about. There's a whole section in the Spirits book, the whole third book in the Spirits book is about the different laws. So what we came to hear to talk about is conscientiousness. How do we acquire conscientiousness? responsibility. I'm always telling everybody, we have to take 100% responsibility for our lives, for our behaviors, what we even think about. So taking responsibility is, again, is not, the conscientiousness is not intellectual. So even though we know something, doesn't necessarily mean we're going to behave conscientiously, right? So for example, a respiratory specialist might know that smoking is really bad because he's all day long working with people with lung cancer and lung issues, but he might go home and relax with a cigarette. So he's not being very conscientious, even though he's intellectually, even though he's intelligent. When I read role models, I thought it's really good to have role models. And then I read in the book, well, we all have role models. We look up to our parents, to our leaders, to our teachers. But if we're here in this as humans, we all have weaknesses. We all have vulnerabilities. So we can become very disappointed in our role models, which really creates a trauma for us when we realize they're not the people we thought they were. So an example that I brought in is, does everybody know Michael Jordan?
Yes.
Basketball player? Well, when my kids were young, that he was like a childhood role model. He was like this fantastic athlete. But within his own group of people, within his own teammates, he was known as a big, bald bully. Because he used to tell his teammates, you know, you're a loser, you've always been a loser. And he would tell, the one that stuck out in my mind was when he was inducted into the Basketball Hall of Fame, he spent the first 20 minutes talking bad about people that had crossed him in his career. He went to the extent of inviting one of his ex-schoolmates to the induction, and then he proceeded to humiliate him because the sophomore coach chose him instead of Jordan for the team. So be careful who is your role model and try to understand that everybody has their weaknesses. I like this one because sometimes it's so difficult for us to face our problems. And usually what happens, we go into denial. And denial really is just a psychological defense so that we don't have to address a possible distressing truth that's appearing in our lives. And so we go into denial, we go into avoidance. We do everything in our power to try to avoid the trauma or the truth that's coming up. So what happens though, if we don't face our problems, they linger in our subconscious as traumas, and later they create some sort of guilt or regret. So it's always good to punch it in the face when it comes at you. I think I have a positive attitude, I hope so. It's people who have positive attitudes actually heal quicker and they heal better. So it's really good to have a positive attitude. People who have negative attitudes actually are more stressed than we are. When we're stressed, we know that we produce more cortisol, our hormones, everything in our body just starts to go out of sync. So, and what happens when we stress? John, we?
Suffer.
So it's great. To, I prompted him from the car before we came. So let's try to keep a positive attitude about life. This one is really interesting. The Stanford University did a study that said that 30 minutes of complaining a day will actually damage our physical brain. Ouch. And the worst part is that whether we're the complainers or whether we're around complainers doesn't make any difference. It still affects the hippocampus, part of our brain where we process information and where we have cognitive function. So, knowing that, I think that we should try to, instead of complaining, create a different habit. It takes about 21 days to change our habit. Let's change our habit to not complain. Or get away from people who complain. This is another study that was done, the University College of London. And experts said that people who are lazy and do not use their time wisely, who become, usually die younger. And the reason that they die younger is because they tend to have unhealthy lifestyles. So they tend to be couch potatoes, they tend to drink more, probably smoke more, they tend to eat more junk food, but they also tend to be more depressive and to have more mental issues. In our Spiritist book, they also say that we become more open to obsessors, to obsession. Obsession is simply when one spirit tries to control or subjugate a weaker spirit. And when that happens, we know what that happens. It creates depression. It can also create criminal behavior. It can create all sorts of problems. So find something to do. Find a goal. Find a passion. Do something that excites you in life. Whatever you do, do it well. Always do your best. So sometimes, as Miguel Ruiz tells us in the Fourth Agreement, the Toltecs agreed with all of us. And they basically said, some days you're not going to feel as well as other days. Your health might be poor. Some days you just might be a little bit more tired. It doesn't matter what you do. It doesn't matter if it's good or it's bad. It just matters that it matters at the end of the day, you want to say, today I did the best I could do with my day. So if you don't do as well today as you did yesterday because you don't feel well, don't judge yourself. Don't, you know, put yourself down. Trust in your own abilities. And this one here was a special one. Yesterday, I was watching my Instagram, and my granddaughter, she's a gymnast, and she put a few videos of herself and her boo-boos and blunders. Now, you have to understand that she's very hard on herself. And this whole trust in your own abilities basically means don't give up, don't surrender. We all make mistakes. That's what we're here for. We just need to keep on pushing it forward. We have our own talents and our own special things that we do well. So what I did is I put the videos for you. This one was her. Oh, William Bennett told us, if at first you don't succeed, try again. So this is her on the first few attempts. After many attempts. Feels good when you keep on trying. Whenever we can't assimilate an experience, it gets stored in the deep archives of our unconscious mind. And what happens is, eventually, it becomes ingrained like a behavior, and eventually what happens is that we have triggers that spark up that trauma, and they just keep on coming back. We keep on putting ourselves in the same situation over and over. Not the same situation, the same emotional situation that causes that trauma, for us to relive the trauma. So basically, traumas cause us conflicts and imbalance and disharmony. In the book, Existential Conflicts, Givaldo Franco tells us that fear, anger, laziness, jealousy, violence, love, death, and psychological escapes are all reasons that we feel conflict. Emotional conflict. Well, that kind of says it all. When you're feeling conflict, you feel like you're being pulled apart in two different directions, right? What happens? I might say, man, I might have done something really bad to you, and I really, really want to apologize and make up. I can't. So I have an emotional conflict. Part of me wants to be your friend again. Part of me says, never. Probably our ego is involved in a lot of this, I would have to say. Also, another example would be, you know, somebody comes to the center every day and they come in with that unfriendly face. They never say hello. They just walk right past you. And you go, you know, I really want to talk to that person. You know, I want to see what they're all about. And then they walk in and you're like, nah, not going to do it. So it's an emotional conflict. And sometimes we don't act conscientiously the way that we should. The way that we should. Fear. Fear, they say, is the opposite of love. But fear is really a natural response to our brain to protect ourselves from the things that are associated with some sort of trauma that we've had. So the example that he gives in the book, and I'm not going to go too much into it, maybe Sherry can talk to us later about it. People who feared the dark, a lot of them were abused as children. So those are just triggers that keep on coming. Fear comes back to kind of protect us so that we don't go into the same place. And again, we're not facing our problems. Anger is just a way that when we can't express ourselves, when we feel like we can't express our real feelings and we feel vulnerable, we become angry. And we try to establish our boundaries again. We try to establish our power by being angry. So the conscientious thing to do is when somebody is angry around you, stop. Understand that all they want to do is explain to you how they're really feeling about a situation. So I was trying to think of my youngest son sometimes used to get really angry when he was little, and it was because we never allowed him to talk. You know, his big brothers were always bullying him, or at least that's what he says. But it created anger inside of him. He never was able to express himself until now as an adult. Anxiety is really when we resist change, and all of us resist change because it's difficult to change. Even making a move from one state to another, any kind of change is difficult. But when we really resist it, we feel anxiety. And I put depression and anxiety together because, as Lao Tzu tells us, if you're anxious, you're living in the future. If you're depressed, you're living in the past with guilt and regret. And if you're at peace, you're living in the present. So that's why I put those two together. People who feel abandoned usually feel lonely and unsupported. So what they do a lot is they will start surrounding themselves with things, relationships, to fill the void, to fill the space. So when we find ourselves feeling lonely, we find ourselves at a loss, and again, all of these things could be coming from past experience, even from a past life. But when we're feeling that way, don't run and try to find the man of your life or the job of your life. Just sit down with yourself, be conscientious, try to think, what is going on, why am I feeling this loss, and how can I fill it in a more conscientious way? Oh, I had an example for this. So, all right, selfishness. We don't like this word very much. In fact, we don't like selfish people very much. But again, the conscientious thing to do is think, why is somebody being so selfish? Well, because they're feeling some sort of a lack. They're feeling lack in their life. They're feeling lack of love. They're feeling lack of support. A good example of this is a child who is in a family who the parents are always saying, you know, we don't have enough money. We're not going to be able to pay our bills. We can't take you bowling with your friends because we don't have money. And you grow up and you say, I'm not going to be like that. I'm going to get a job. I'm going to have a lot of money. And you do. You become very, very rich and very, very selfish. And people go, why is he so selfish? He has so much. And it's because he still has the poverty mentality from when he was a child. He still is feeling that lack from childhood, which is a childhood trauma. Jealousy, again, is just feeling insecure. We need to stop and try to understand, why are we feeling jealous? Why do we think something is being taken away from us? Nothing belongs to us in the first place, so it can't be taken away from us. But we do feel insecure and jealous. I was going to give you an example of my own jealousy and decided, no. So with all of that being said, how can we avoid all of these conflicts? Well, I went back to the spirits book, and Kardec asks the spirits, where do a person's good or bad moral qualities come from? They reflect the qualities of the incarnate spirit. In other words, they reflect the quality our qualities. Okay? The purer the spirit, the more the person is inclined toward the good. So, and the more good we do, the more harmony we feel. The more harmony we feel, the less
suffering
we have. Less suffering we have.
You're drinking water.
Why don't some people heal? You know, what is the illness? How is the illness serving you? Because that happens sometimes. We think, you know, They have the best doctors, they have everything. Why don't they heal and the other person does heal? Well, there are many reasons for that. I'm going to give you a few that were in the book. Guilt and shame. Guilt will keep us in the past, will keep us with feeling regret, remorse, guilt and shame. So what happens? Our vibrations are lowered, so we tend to keep on attracting situations that bring back the triggers for that same trauma that we have. You know, give an example, let's say. A young girl has an abortion at 18 because she gets pregnant, has an abortion. She has this guilt inside of her. When she gets older, she sabotages every single relationship she has because she doesn't think she's worthy of having a relationship and a family because of what she did in the past. So it's not worth it. Guilt is not there to keep us backwards. Guilt is there to teach us a lesson. What matters isn't what's good or what's bad, what we did. What matters is, what are we going to do with it now to create some sort of harmony in our lives and then the lives of other people, because we may have hurt other people in the process. So sometimes we even feel guilty when we try to establish boundaries. Sometimes we feel we're not going to be loved if we establish a boundary and we let people walk all over us. So guilt, per se, is something that we need to work with. Resentment. How many people here have felt resentment? They just can't let go of that thing that you did to me. It's like, oh my God, I don't even want to forgive you. I want to feel resentful. So, and a lot of times too, we want to be appreciated. And we get resentful when we do something for somebody and they don't even thank you for it. And that stays in our mind. It's like, you know, we feel we're being used. And nobody likes that. Again, the reason I put that, because why don't some people heal? Because sometimes we don't want to make up with the person. We want to be mad at the person. It feels good to be mad at the person, so we think. Lack of self-worth, lack of self-esteem. This is when we think we're never good enough. We are not really fulfilling what we came to do. Or, you know, this one here, when I was reading it, what caught my attention was when people tell me, I never could do anything to make my father happy. I was just never good enough. And it's hard to get over that. Fear of stepping outside of our comfort zones. We love our comfort zones. It's comfortable. The word says it all. It's safe. In Spanish, we have a saying that says, mejor malo por conocido que bueno por conocer. It's better to have something bad that we know and are familiar with than to have something good that we don't know anything about. So the only problem with that is that if we don't move out of our comfort zone, we don't evolve. And the whole reason we're here is to grow up, right? To evolve, to become better people. Before, we talked about taking responsibility, but some people don't want to heal. Some people sabotage their own healing because they don't want to take responsibility. It's much easier not to take responsibility. So, what kinds of people don't want to take responsibility? Anybody?
Irresponsible.
Irresponsible? That's a good answer. That's correct, actually.
Politicians.
Narcissists.
Narcissists. Okay, so we have the dramatic people. They don't want to take responsibility. They feel invisible. They feel lonely. They feel rejected. So they need to be heard. And so they become drama queens. So instead of taking responsibility for what they're doing, they're just creating drama all over the place. We know a few of those. The blaming person. I don't want to focus on my own personal development. Things aren't going exactly how I wanted, so it must not be my fault. It definitely has to be your fault. It can't be me. So we direct the blame to somebody else. Manipulative person. That's actually a way to control people. Manipulative people it's just a hidden control. We all manipulate. We manipulate our children, we manipulate everybody around us. Sometimes we know we're manipulating and sometimes we don't. Resistance to change comes again. This is the person who has no one can fix it attitude. So the resistance to change is, why should I change? Nothing is going to change anyway. So they get stuck in there. They don't want to take responsibility for creating change. Selective hearing. This one reminds me of my children. God, are you wrong in study? What? Selective hearing is when actually a trigger, something has triggered them and, or people in their mind, and suddenly they stop hearing, and it's very selective what they hear. And you go, that's not what I'm saying, that's not what I'm said, but they can't because you've triggered some sort of trauma in their subconscious. So some people just can't feel emotions. It's easier to suppress your emotions than to actually deal with them. And those people are actually very hard to deal with because we don't know what they're feeling. And they probably don't even know what they're feeling. So, as we grow older, a lot of these characteristics that we've been speaking about, we can actually change them. So maturity is going to be when we actually acknowledge that we're the source or the cause of the problem, or a problem, or something. Okay, that's really hard, by the way, because we don't like to admit that we've done something wrong. We don't like to admit we've been the problem. And by the way, maturity is not just, just when you're little and you're growing up to become mature, is not necessarily true. How many people know of a completely grown man and we go, oh my God, he's a boy in a man's body. He just never grew up. So maturity is a process of learning and growth throughout our lives. How we respond to our demons, how we respond to our conflicts and our traumas is really important because we can either choose to use it as an experience or we can not. So if we don't, if we do, we will actually notice a difference in behavior, more calm, inner peace. We need to release feelings of anger and resentment because they keep us stuck. They keep us stuck in a very dark place. It poisons our body when we're angry. It doesn't, it hurts us more than the other person. We need to learn that forgiveness is empowerment. Forgiveness is about us. It's not about the other person. We can actually not forgive somebody that has no idea that we're mad at them or why we're mad at them. So it's not about them. It's always about us, okay? Anytime that you have a difficult time forgiving, that you want vengeance, you want payback, I'm gonna get them. I'm gonna get them worse than they got me. Well, at the end of the day, that creates just a vicious cycle of more negative thoughts. And then it starts going in your head over and over and over. You go to sleep at night and you think about it over and over and over again. And it just drives you simply crazy. It doesn't take you anywhere. There is no spiritual growth. There is no conscientiousness. There's no conscious behavior in any of that. You have to remember that your past is just merely a story. It's just a chapter in your book of life. There's always a new chapter. Write a different story. Change your story if you don't like it. So if you keep that in mind and you know that the plot doesn't have to thicken, you can change your life. Open yourself to more excitement and positive experiences. So here, positive experiences. When we serve and we help other people, it makes us feel really good, right? Anybody ever done something nice for somebody? A compassionate, it feels really, really good. So keep it in mind, that creates a wonderful behavior within ourselves. The other thing is, open yourself to excitement. Go take a tango class for crying out loud. Do something you've never done. Be adventurous, get a little passion in your life. That will actually make you feel good. All those positive attitudes, all those good emotions will start coming out. So another section of the book, and again, this book, remember, had a lot of different sections to it. It was hard to create a flow because they were all separate subjects. So there's a whole area, a whole topic on karma, death, and reincarnation. So karma really is just the law of cause and effect. For every action, there's a reaction. So we're not destined to have bad karma like we think. We're not destined to have bad things happen to us, illnesses or accidents. Everything is coming from some sort. Everything is a reaction from something that we did in the past, either in a past life or that we may have committed wrongdoings or crimes or something that never came to justice, and now in our new birth, they're coming in a different way. Or it could be in this own life where we've done wrongdoing, and now guess what? We need to fix it. You know, it's a pendulum. What goes up must come down. It's the law of karma. So the good news in Spiritism is that we believe in reincarnation. So we're going to have a lot of opportunities to get good karma, because the more conscientious you are and the better the difference in behavior that you have will actually create good karma. Now, people who are very materialistic and very much into their bodies tend to be more afraid of death than other people. And that's because they believe that when you die, and you're gone. But our bodies are really fragile. They're really delicate. Think about it. We could be walking outside and a truck runs over us and poof, we're dead. Gone. You know, we could go get a virus, a bacteria. Infection kills us. Or we could just get old and there's wear and tear on the body, you know, there's degeneration and we just die. So we're going to die. There's no escaping death. But the thought of reincarnation helps us, because it helps us in our actually everyday behavior. Because if we know that we're here to evolve and we know that we're here to grow, that gives us incentive to actually act conscientiously. So reincarnation is really an instrument for spiritual progress, right? Because it gives us an opportunity to keep on redoing and redoing. Whatever name you want to give reincarnation, but we're energy. We don't disappear. We know that from science. I think that without reincarnation, life wouldn't make very much sense, because why are some people so lucky, so blessed, and some people so cursed? It just doesn't, you know, and some people are cursed from birth. This is my little chart, which after I did it, I'm like, oh God, I hope it makes sense. Every spirit, every person reincarnates into the home it needs in order to evolve. So guess what? Can't complain about your parents. Can't complain about your brothers and sisters. We came into the family that is giving us the most opportunity to teach us the purpose we came to fulfill, okay? So for example, if I have music talent and I come into this life, I will either choose a family who will encourage my musical talent, or I will come into a family who will challenge my musical talent. And now I have to, as a spirit, as a person, overcome the challenge. Can I overcome it? Am I going to be able to fulfill my musical talent? Okay, so we are coming into an environment of teaching. If we look at it that way, nothing really seems all that bad, right? So we choose our soul's purpose at conception, at birth. So when we come in, we already know basically what our purpose is. Whether we fulfill it or not is going to depend about us, okay? So inner transformation then becomes about, actually there was a question in the Spirits book that said, what is the most effective means for improving ourselves in life? And the Spirits actually answered, a sage of antiquity has told you, know thyself. Does anybody know who that sage was? Socrates. Yeah. So none of this is new information. We all know this already. Inner transformation, of course, is an important part of our growth. It's an evolution of our growth, okay? We're here to evolve. We're destined for perfection. Health is really our natural state. All those illnesses, those accidents, all those things that happen in our life are little bumps in the road because of choices we made, or choices we made in the past, or choices that we're making in the present. So don't surrender, don't feel upset, just keep on moving forward. Know that this is just evolving. You know, I love to think of us as light, and we're all just a little spark of light. And if we evolve and we can do inner transformation, we can like turn on that light switch and light up the room, right? So think about it when you're dark, you're feeling in that dark space. Remember, you're the light. All you have to do is turn on that switch. We need to, when we create good habits, and by the way, it takes about 21 days to create a habit, good or bad, but if we are conscientious and try to create good habits, like create a habit of exercising, and we do this, if we exercise for 21 days, suddenly it becomes much easier to exercise. And if we can let go of old habits, which also takes 21 days to do, so if you want to quit smoking, you're going to have to at least quit for 21 days, probably more because it's so addictive. But inner transformation happens when we create new habits, good habits, okay? Gratitude is a gimme. We all know that feeling grateful about everything makes us feel good. And on this one here, I have a little story because my mother was grateful for every day of her life. My mom loves life. She's 94, hopefully watching me right now. Hi, Mom. And I have a little story because every once in a while I tend to get down and troubled. You know, I go into my victimhood and I go into a bad place. But my mom, every day, man, it was just the best day of her life. And several years ago, my sister called me up to tell me that she had fallen. And my dad didn't find her for 2 hours because he couldn't hear her screaming. And if I could go up and take care of her. So I said, sure, why not? So I told my mom, sleep in bed with me so I know I can get up with you when you go to the bathroom and you don't fall. Well, I sleep all night. So waking up every hour, I was exhausted in the morning. I wanted to die, and I finally went into that wonderful, beautiful sleep, and I see my mom's face this close to me, and she's staring at me, and I'm like, hey, Mom, what do you want? And she goes, ay, muñeca. I've been all morning trying to figure out how I'm going to convince myself that I'm old. She's just so cute. I mean, it's just unbelievable. Now, I can't talk about my mom without talking about my dad. He's 96, and he's watching me too, I hope. My dad, the biggest lesson that he taught me when I was young was that to be present. My dad worked for the State Department, and that's why I was born in Brazil. And he could talk to a dignitary the same way he would talk to the gardener. He was always present with the person. And I remember seeing this as a young child and just thinking, I want to be just like that when I grow up. I don't want to be thinking of something else when I'm speaking with somebody. And he still does that. He's old now, but when he talks to you, you know that he's truly interested in what you have to say. Being present makes us feel like one, makes us feel like we're part of one world. And that feeling of separateness that we have completely dissipates when we're present. Inner balance. Well, this one is kind of also self-explanatory. If we're feeling inner balance and we're feeling harmony within, it's much easier for us to get over an argument quickly. We're still going to have arguments. We're still going to have moments when things are going bad. But when we have some sort of inner balance, it just fixes quicker. We get over it a lot faster. So inner transformation, by the way, before I come into this next pass, sounds really simple, but it's really not. It's being aware 24/7 of our behavior, what we're thinking, what we're doing, our actions, our relationships. It's never stopping for one moment and ignoring life. So just remember, be aware. Now, I brought in passes because passes is another way that we can feel harmony within, okay? Passes is sort of an energy healing type that we do in the Spiritus Center. I believe it's a Spiritus word. I've never heard passes before. And it's the transfer of energy from one being to another. So you see in the picture here where you have a spirit benefactor, you have the person giving the passes, and you have the patient. The passes are going to revitalize our vital fluids, which are really our energy. It's going to revitalize us. It's going to work wherever it is that we have some sort of imbalance in our heart. So if we're feeling a lot of sadness, the energy is going to go towards our heart chakra. And it improves the harmony of our body. So it can actually help us heal from a physical or a mental, emotional, and emotional way. So right after, I'm not going to speak much because my time is up. But right after this, we're actually, everybody will receive a pass if you choose to receive a pass. Just really quick, I wanted to give you some examples of how emotions affect our physical body. Thyroid problems. Thyroid problems are kind of, you can see that you have, it's going to be in the throat area, it's going to be communication. Thyroid problems are when people are feeling misunderstood, when they're not able to get their message out and really tell people what they really feel. So when they can't do that, they start, the energy starts to accumulate, kind of like a bruise, an energetic bruise on your throat, and it creates thyroid problems. So next time somebody, you don't understand what somebody is trying to tell you, be conscientious and say, can you repeat that? I don't understand it. Can you tell me in a different way? Give me an example, and it will actually, you are actually serving the other person. Lower back pains. A lot of people have lower back pains. Lower back pains actually are when you have so much responsibility, you're feeling overwhelmed, and you really can't support yourself. You feel like you can't support yourself. A lot of times they relate to lower back pain also as some sort of financial. You can't support yourself financially. Diabetes. I brought that one up for a reason. So by the way, I study three different people for all of these emotions. I studied Louise Hayes in the beginning. She has wonderful affirmations. I studied Yvette Rose, who wrote a book called Metaphysical Anatomy, and Dr. Hammer, who actually has, they call it new medicine. And what he does is he associates past trauma and conflicts with cancer, what causes the cancer, okay? So with the diabetes, most doctors say that when a person comes in and is diagnosed with diabetes, they're going through extremely a lot of stress in their life. There's a lot of stress and anxiety over situations that you can't control, okay? So also, it's going to be, a lot of times you hear of diabetes as being a lack of joy. Well, of course, if you can't control your situation and you're feeling anxiety, you're feeling a total lack of joy. But it can also be from a trigger of a loss in the past that you weren't able to process, a loss of a loved one that you never really processed, and some situation triggers it in your life when you have a lot of stress. I chose rashes because I just thought it was so funny. When somebody is really irritating you, you get a rash. Well, next time you start scratching like that, start thinking, who is irritating me to death? Now, there, of course, are different kinds of rashes, but I brought sciatica too, because sciatica sometimes is when we feel that our boundaries are being overpassed. So when we're feeling a little bit out of control, that somebody is like imposing themselves in our lives, or they're using us as a scapegoat, and we're feeling that lack of boundary, a lot of times it will show up in your sciatica. So in summary, ways to be conscientious, we're just going to repeat. Have good judgment. Have discernment. Be committed and serve. Do your duty. We're here to work and help each other. Have good moral character. We know, remember, the laws of God are in our conscience. At some level, we know when we're doing something that's not nice. Take responsibility. We talked thoroughly about that one. Have integrity. Be honest. Be sincere with what you do. In fact, when you play words with your friends on apps, don't cheat. It is not fun to play with a cheater. Oh, wait a minute. So with that, I wanted to thank you, and I wanted to leave you with the message, in a world where you can be anything, be kind. Thank you.